All right, everybody. Today I want to show why I believe that Revelation chapter 12 is exclusively about the Virgin Mary. Now, I know that even some church fathers would interpret Revelation 12 to include the church. And Protestants usually say, based on some of the passages in the Old Testament, which we'll go through here in a moment, that supposedly that is about Israel, right? Now, one could argue that in a loose sense, right, perhaps I myself could agree that it could still be Israel and it could still be, but in an extremely, extremely loose sense. If you really are honest with yourself and you take the passage of Revelation 12 literally, you cannot come to any other conclusion than that it is primarily about the Virgin Mary, and I would even argue it's only about her. The passages that we read in the Old Testament about where Israel is compared to a woman, those are only metaphorical. That was the type, right? And many a times, we see this phenomena, and I'm going to show this even about Jesus Christ. There are Psalms, for example, there's a Psalm, Psalm 69, which I'll go through in a moment, which there is content in it that could apply to the crucifixion of Christ. But then there is also content in it that shows it's not literally about Christ yet, it's about a historical figure, likely King David himself, first and foremost. So Christ is the anti-type, the real, actual fulfillment. And that's what we're going to see here. Same applies to these passages. So let's go through them for a moment. Isaiah 26, chapter 26, verses 17 to 18. Here it says, like as a woman with child. Notice it also says like. Usually when the Bible says like, it's not exactly that entity that comes after, like in this case a woman. So it's not actually a woman. Like when Christ said in the resurrection, we will be like angels. Does that mean we'll actually be angels? Our nature will become angelic, i.e. we'll lose our body? No, of course not. Right? Most Protestants, if not all of them, except the Gnostics, believe in a bodily resurrection. So like angels is an analogy, is not exactly that. So even here we get a hint already, as we will see in Revelation 12, where it says, the woman, that is an actual woman, whereas this is just a likening to a woman. Like as a woman with child, that draws near the time of her delivery, is in pain and cries out in her pangs. So have we been in thy sight, O Lord. Now, someone may argue, well, but wait a minute, in Revelation 12, isn't that a Jewish theme that St. John the Apostle saw? Yeah, but even the apostles and what Christ did is all based on a Jewish theme, isn't it? God continues to use Jewish numbers and symbolisms. Why do you think Christ picked exactly 12 apostles? Now, so if we went by this faulty Protestant logic that they apply to Revelation 12, then I can say, well, the 12 apostles must be a reincarnation of the 12 patriarchs of Israel. Do you now see what a joke this is? Right here in the beginning, I want to show you the absurdity of that kind of reasoning. So just because we find a pattern, a historical pattern in the Old Testament that matches something in the New Testament, doesn't mean that the entity is identical. Now let us continue. We have been with child, we have been in pain, we have, as it were, brought forth wind. We have not wrought any deliverance in the earth, neither have the inhabitants of the fallen world. Isaiah 54, chapter 54, verse 1. Sing, O barren, thou that didst not bear. Break forth into singing and cry aloud, thou that didst not travail with child. For more are the children of the desolate than the children of the married wife, saith the Lord. Isaiah 66, verses 7 to 12. Before she travaileth, she brought forth. Before her pain came, she was delivered of a man-child. Notice it says a man-child, and the phrase man-child is used for many people throughout the Old Testament, not just one individual. And we will see in Revelation 12, it is a particular man-child. Right? In the context, it provides us who this man-child is. Over here, this man-child is not talking about the Messiah. There's no indication in this passage that this man-child over here is the Messiah. None whatsoever. So this is obviously in a historical context. It refers to the many man-childs, maybe the prophets of the old, some prophet of the Old Testament, some new prophet, or some new holy men under the Old Covenant, which is a picture of the ultimate man-child obviously Jesus Christ himself. In the same way, the woman, these weak shadows of the woman, then we have the ideal woman. And that's the one who is described in Revelation 12, as we shall see. Who has heard such a thing? Who has seen such things? Shall the earth be made to bring forth in one day, or shall a nation be born at once? For as soon as Zion travailed, she brought forth her children. So here it even describes that Zion is meant here. So this is clearly a metaphor. Right? This is from the context itself. We will see in Revelation 12 that's not the case. In a moment. Shall I bring to the birth and not cause to bring forth, says the Lord? Shall I cause to bring forth and shut the womb, says thy God? Rejoice ye with Jerusalem and be glad with her, all ye that love her. Rejoice for joy with her, all ye that mourn for her. Talking about Jerusalem. That ye may suck and be satisfied with the breasts of her consolations, that ye may milk out and be delighted with the abundance of her glory. For thus saith the Lord, behold, I will extend peace to her like a river, and the glory of the Gentiles like a flowing stream. Then shall ye suck, ye shall be born upon her sides, and be dandled upon her knees. Obviously, this is not talking about the Messiah, and it's not talking about, it is talking about Jerusalem of the Old Testament, right? In contrast to Revelation 12, which we will see in a moment. Now, before we go there, there is another passage that's often brought up, and that is Genesis chapter 37. I've seen this brought up a lot by Protestant or Protestant-minded people. Or I've just seen it brought up by them. It says, for behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheaf arose, and also stood upright. And behold, your sheaves stood round about, and made obeisance to my sheaf. And his brethren said to him, shalt thou indeed reign over us, or shalt thou indeed have dominion over us? And they hated him yet the more for his dreams and for his words. This is about the prophet Joseph's dream. And he dreamt yet another dream, and told it his brethren, and said, behold, I have dreamt a dream more. And behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars made obeisance to me. So him being the 12th star, he's saying here in this dream, it's implied that he is the 12th star. The other 11 are the other his brethren. The sun and the moon and the 11 made obeisance to me, or bowed down to him. Right? Proskuneson is the Greek translation of the word. I'm not sure what the Hebrew is, but okay, obeisance, bowing down to him, right? And he told it to his father and to his brethren, and his father rebuked him and said unto him, what is this dream that thou hast dreamt? Shall I and thy mother and thy brethren indeed come to bow down ourselves to thee, to the earth? So some will say, see, well, in Revelation 12, that's like Joseph. But wait a minute, we already saw in the other passage, first of all, that woman is not Joseph, obviously. That woman is Jerusalem, the corrective Jerusalem. So why even bring that passage up then and smuggle it into Revelation 12? When this is just about an individual man, i.e. Joseph, you see? Secondly, again, I explained already that just like the number 12, the symbols of the Old Testament are repeated, but for new individuals in the New Testament, so also we see in Revelation 12, this, yes, there are elements of this, like the sun and the moon and the 11 stars, or actually it says 12 stars over there, but there it talks about a crown. That woman in Revelation 12, as we shall see, she has a crown on her head with 12 stars. Did Joseph have a crown of 11 on his head? No. Was Joseph clothed with the sun, as it says in Revelation 12? No, he wasn't. So this is a weak picture. This is very weak. There's a world of a difference between the sun showing obeisance to you, let's say the sun symbolically, and the stars engage in obeisance towards you. That's one thing. They give you honor. They accept you as an authority, let's say, over you. It's a whole other thing being clothed with the sun altogether. Nowhere is Joseph said to be clothed with the sun. In fact, I would argue if he would clothe himself with the sun, he would probably get destroyed in his old state. He could not even tolerate that because he was not ready for that at his time. and don't believe any Old Testament saint was. You have to have a very high level of perfection. By the grace of God, mind you. Not independent of God, but by the very grace of God, in order to be clothed with the Son itself. And we'll get there in a moment. Now let us see Psalm 69 to make this point, to drive this point home, that sometimes in the Old Testament, even when we talk about a passage that talks about, that foreshadows Christ, not every aspect is applied to him, and therefore it's not for first and foremost talking about the individual of Christ Jesus himself in its historical context. Let's look at Psalm 69. Let's read this together. Save me, O God, for the waters are come in unto my soul. I sink in deep mire where there is no standing. I am come into deep waters where the floods overflow me. I am weary of my crying. My throat is dried. Now here, people link this to the crucifixion. And that is, in a sense, is correct. This can be applied to the crucifixion event of Christ and has been done so historically by both, us Orthodox and the Protestants as well. And of course, the Roman Catholics, they also applied it to Christ. I am weary of my crying, my throat is dried, mine eyes fail while I wait for my God. They that hate me without a cause, see that? Hate me without a cause. Wasn't that Christ was hated without a cause? Obviously, every Protestant would agree. So they say, see, this is about Christ. Okay, but let's continue. They that hate me without a cause are more than the hairs of mine head. They that would destroy me, being mine enemies wrongfully, are mighty. Then I restored that which I took not away. And now watch this, verse 5. O God, thou knowest my foolishness. Wait, what? God forbid, is any Protestant going to tell me, or anyone for that matter, that Christ was foolish? No, of course not. That's unthinkable. No Protestant would commit such a blasphemy. But then it continues, watch. And my sins are not hid from thee. Wait, what? Christ, God forbid, he had sins? No, of course not. We all know Christ was the only sinless one. He was perfectly sinless. He had neither original sin nor actual sin. He never committed any sins. You see? So obviously, none of this in this verse applies to Christ. So it's obviously this is either talking about King David himself or someone in his time. Most likely King David is describing himself. Because he was a foreshadow. So these are recurrent events. So King David already lived through hardships and trials where his enemies were trying to destroy him. And he felt hopeless for a while. This already happened, Protestants. And then God reuses elements of this picture and applies it to Christ in a more perfect or in the most perfect manner. The ultimate fulfillment, so to speak. And this is the exact same theme that is going on in Revelation chapter 12. And that's where we're going to go to right now. I'm going to open Revelation chapter 12. And we will see. Now let's read this very carefully. And there appeared a great wonder in heaven. Notice here also the word great, mega in the Greek. A mega sign. Wonder, by the way, just means sign. So wonder is not the special word, because as we will see later on, it also applies to the dragon. But then it won't say great. Very important. So the first sign here is a great sign. This means this is huge. This entity is big. This stands above all, right? Above all other creatures. And there appeared a great wonder in heaven. A woman clothed with the sun. And watch this. And the moon under her feet. Did Saint Joseph have the moon under his feet? Is that what the text says? No, it doesn't. So as you can see, this is a more powerful description. This never happened in the history. Yes, there is a theme of the sun and the moon there. There is still a Jewish theme, because after all, isn't the Virgin Mary a Jewish woman? So obviously, God is going to apply the Jewish symbolism to her. This is not even in question. But how on earth does that conclude that she, that this woman is just the same entity that God was talking about in the Old Testament? It's not. And by the way, isn't it in the Gospel of John where Christ says to John, behold thy mother, even though she wasn't the real mother of John the theologian or John the apostle? Even Protestants admit that. So obviously Saint John is shown the... You only have to put two and two together to see that St. John is actually seeing the Virgin Mary here in the dream. That's the great sign he's seeing. Not Jerusalem anymore. That's in the past. That's a foreshadow. This is the antitype. This is the ultimate fulfillment. This is the woman. Now watch. And she being with child cried, travailing in birth, and pained to be delivered. And by the way, when it talks about pain, because we, of course, as Orthodox, we believe in the same holy tradition. We share this view with the Roman Catholics, that the Virgin Mary never suffered from labor pains internally. That means from her own body, she was not experiencing any pain. However, the pain that she experienced there was externally. I would argue, not just because of course, there was the whole accusation, you know, of her not being chaste and all that, and that troubled her, but also the persecution of Herod, trying to kill or going after every firstborn child, including the Virgin Mary. She obviously knew about that, and she, I believe, also knew it on a spiritual level, because we will read about the dragon, who is the devil, in a moment. And just to show you that this is also can be proven from the scriptures, in Galatians chapter 4, verse 19, we see the Apostle Paul saying, my little children, which by the way completely refutes the Protestant idea that there is no concept of spiritual father, right? Like when Christ said, call no man on earth father. First of all, notice he said, on earth. What did the Apostle Paul say? Those who are in Christ are seated in heavenly places. So in a sense, the priests and the clergy aren't even on earth, but they're also seated in heavenly places. Secondly, here he says, clearly, my little children, clearly implying that he is their spiritual father, right? So we got that out of the way as well. So again, killing two birds with one stone. Two false Protestant heresies with one blow. My little children, of whom I travail in birth again until Christ be formed in you. Here you see it. The travailing. So this is a metaphorical travailing. And that's exactly how we understand Revelation 12 as well. So there is no problem. Lest anybody say, well, but don't you Orthodox believe that the Virgin Mary didn't have any labor pains? Yeah, she didn't have. Internally, she didn't have any. From her body, she didn't have any. These were external pains that she was caused because she knew the devil was after her child. And that's exactly what we'll see when we continue in the context. And there appeared another wonder. Now notice it says just wonder. It doesn't say great wonder. And wonder, by the way, here is just sign. Right? It's not the modern English word wonder, like, oh, this is so awesome. No, this is a sign. A sign in heaven. And there appeared another wonder, because I'm reading the King James. And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon, having seven heads and ten horns, and seven crowns upon his head, upon his heads. And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven, and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. And now we'll see who this child is, because this child is not just any prophet. This child is not just any Israelite. This child is not any collective community of Israelites. But who is it? And she brought forth a man-child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron, and her child was caught up unto God and to his throne. Right there we see this is obviously the Lord Jesus Christ being described over here. There is no way around it, Protestants. So now we have, even Protestants have to admit, there's at least two individuals spoken of. The child is an individual, Jesus Christ. The dragon is an individual, the devil himself, right? The great red dragon, who later on down will be described as the devil in the book of Revelation itself, I believe in the same chapter later on. So these two already Protestants accept to be individuals. So then why this inconsistency and say, oh, but the woman is a collective? Isn't that ironic? That it's speaking about the devil being the greatest enemy of the woman, and that same devil seems to confuse you Protestants into acknowledging that, yes, his greatest enemy amongst creatures is that very woman, the Virgin Mary. Because was Israel really the greatest enemy of the devil? No, not so much. Because they gave in to the devil quite a few times. Right? But the Virgin Mary did not give in to the devil. Right? She followed the will of Christ. She was not disobedient to Christ. Right? And she is given that honor. That's why she is said to be clothed with the sun. This is the highest honor you can give. Right? To a creature. As is being described in this chapter. So why this inconsistency? Obviously, this is the devil who makes you Protestants become inconsistent. But hopefully now you see this before your eyes. If you accept two of them as individuals and you need to be logically consistent, then you must accept the woman to be an individual as well in this chapter. There's no way around it. And the woman fled into the wilderness where she has a place prepared of God that they should feed her there 1,260 days. Now you see the repetitive theme over here that's also used to be this, the same number used for the Great Tribulation. Some people therefore argue, this is where some of my Orthodox brethren and even Roman Catholics, they will argue, well, because this is why it's also talking about the church, because the church later will flee into the wilderness and will be persecuted. But the problem is, even if we accept that, we have to admit that first and foremost, literally in its historical context, when the Apostle John was writing, he was seeing the Virgin Mary. He wasn't yet seeing the church there. You can, as is often the case with the scriptures, you can then apply them in a very loose sense to that as well. Because guess what? Did the church give birth to Christ? Not really. I mean, not the new. You could make more of an argument that the old covenant church gave birth to Christ. So there, actually, the Protestants have more of a. It makes more sense to say that it's Israel, because then you can say that was before Christ. So they came together to give, even though they didn't. None of the Israelites consciously came together at that moment. They were all unaware when Christ was being born. Only the Virgin Mary knew first and foremost. And then she told Saint Joseph about it. So actually, there isn't. I don't see that connection as such. I personally don't see it. So I don't even agree. But the irony is that sometimes here Protestants would likely jump to the fathers and say, see, even the fathers admitted it can have more than one meaning. Even the fathers said there's a church. Yeah, but what you Protestants don't understand is that we Orthodox, as well as Roman Catholics, as well as I believe the Copts and the Assyrian Church of the East, we are all in agreement with this, that individual church fathers can be wrong, can be mistaken. I mean, don't you get this? So for you to show us individual church fathers, and it's very ironic because I'm showing you the scripture is very explicit. So wait a minute, are you going to take church fathers over scripture now? What is that? So you abandon your method now all of a sudden? Just because you want to go against your... This is the madness of Protestantism. I got to say it, folks. This is the madness. The devil has made them so mad that they will actually jump on the fathers against their own view of sola scriptura from time to time, just to try to prove us wrong. Complete and utter madness, man. Unbelievable. But let us continue. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels, and prevailed not. Neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knows that he has but a short time. And when the dragon saw that he was cast unto the earth, he persecuted the woman. Now it switches to the woman, which brought forth the man-child. And to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle. And that's why, by the way, I've seen icons depicting the Virgin Mary with two wings. Right? And this is also, I believe, closely connected to the Assumption of the Virgin Mary. So here she's given two wings, and then later, which is described first, because the book of Revelation doesn't always describe things in order. So as we saw before, when the Apostle John saw her in heaven, she was clothed with the sun. Clearly, she had to have been assumed. But here we see she's also given wings. And if you take this literally, which I personally do, some people just take this symbolically, I don't. I think this is literal wings. This woman, the Virgin Mary, was actually given the honor of given to actual wings, right? Which she has to this very day. And I believe these wings might be obtainable by some high-level saints, right, as well, but not all of them. Certainly the Virgin Mary, because she's the highest of all creatures, and that's why she's given the honor of being mentioned in Revelation. And to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness, into a place where she is nourished for a time and times and half a time, from the face of the serpent. So there was actually a war going on earth between the Virgin Mary and the devil. And not once, but twice, as we saw before, when she was still about to be delivered, that's when the devil wanted to. And I believe this was both through Herod and on a spiritual level as well, because I take this passage literally. And a second time, when Christ was already assumed, the Virgin Mary was again persecuted by the devil. That's how great of an enemy the serpent is. And that's why we Orthodox agree with the Roman Catholics as well, that the woman mentioned in Genesis when it comes to, I will put enmity between you and her seed, right? It's also talking about the Virgin Mary, not about the old Eve. Because you could easily become confused and say, well, but all this time in Genesis 3 is talking about Eve. Yeah, but the problem is God did not have to put enmity. If you think about it, I would argue reasonably, it doesn't make any sense to say that God will put enmity between Eve and the devil. Right? Because Eve would live her 500 to 1,000 years as people would live that while, and then she would pass away herself. So what great significance does that carry? Right? So this must be talking about a woman who would, once she is born, from that moment on, there is a continuity. And that's why we believe that the Virgin Mary did not die in the normal sense, that she fell asleep and then was assumed after that. You see? So it was something very special. Right? And this woman obviously is alive with her body in heaven to this very day. And then it makes sense to say that I will put enmity between you and the woman. Notice it says future sense. Eve was already there. So, and she was already at enmity. Do you really believe that after the devil had just deceived her, that Eve isn't already saying, get lost, you serpent, I never want to see you again? Obviously, she's had that experience, right? She's never going to come near that serpent ever again. So that enmity was already there. But the Lord says, I will put enmity, right? So this has to be talking about the future woman. That's a great mystery. Sometimes the scriptures do this, even in the Old Testament. That it is even though the same phrase is used, it's talking about a different individual in the future. And that's exactly what I believe Genesis 3 is about, right? Both us, the Orthodox and the Roman Catholics, are absolutely correct when it comes to this point. The woman who is then, and we see this animosity being played out here. Now, this is clearly, even according to Protestants, this is not about Eve, right? At all. You would say this is about Israel, but wait a minute. Are you telling me that God was saying in Genesis 3, I put enmity between you and Israel? Makes absolutely no sense, right? Even from the Protestant perspective. So what other woman is left then? What other individual woman is left? Can only be the Virgin Mary. And that's why, by the way, the Virgin Mary is called the New Eve as well. That's where we draw that connection. Now watch this. From the face of the serpent, and the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood after the woman. Now some can say, you can say that this water is a group of soldiers, physical human soldiers, because the book of Revelation elsewhere calls that, you know, the water is the many people. But that's in a different context, that many chapters later, and is in a different context. In this context, it does not qualify this water as being a group of people. So I can argue, if there's no other qualification, why not take it literally? And it even says, as a flood after the woman. So there was likely a flood supernaturally brought about by the devil to persecute the Virgin Mary. This is what it says literally. So if you want to be honest to the text, and this is the irony, that here Protestants have to, in order to get away from the Virgin Mary, and from her honor, and to steal from her honor that Christ has given her, they have to make everything symbolic. Isn't that ironic? Now, another big irony is, of course, in Revelation 20, when it talks about the 1,000 years, there we have dispensationalists, you know, taking that literally, which actually is a condemned teaching by the church, and for good reasons. Because if we contradict 2 Peter 3 completely, and other passages, where Christ talks about that in 1 hour, both the wicked ones and the righteous ones will be resurrected. In 1 hour. Not one first, because according to dispensationalism, according to millennialism, you have a first resurrection of the righteous only, and then you have 1,000-year reign, and then you have the second resurrection. That's not 1 hour. Okay? So that completely contradicts the Apostle John, the same apostle who wrote the book of Revelation. That wouldn't make any sense. But that's not the topic of discussion today. I just want to, you know, show about, make it very clear that this is about the Virgin Mary. And in my opinion, nobody else. So I take the side of those church fathers who only talk about this being the Virgin Mary. I do not talk about, I don't believe personally that this is about the church. Maybe in a very loose sense. Similarly, I don't believe this is about Israel anymore. Yes, there are elements of Israel being used here, but I told you already, same with the apostles. We have 12 apostles. That don't make the apostles equal to the reincarnation of the 12 patriarchs. Very simple. And the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood after the woman, and that he might cause her to be carried away of the flood. And the earth helped the woman, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed up the flood which the dragon cast out of his mouth. And the dragon was wroth with the woman, and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God. Now this is the church, and this is why the reason is why I also rule out the church, because this would be the church. The remnant of her seed. So she is the mother of the church. And who is the mother of the church? Christ himself said it to John. John is one of the 12 apostles, i.e. the church, i.e. a representative of the church, and says to him, behold your mother. So who is the mother of the church? The Virgin Mary. There's no way around it. This is biblical. This is scriptural. Anything else is traditions of men. Right? And the dragon was wroth with, or a butchering of scripture. And the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. So now I hope you Protestants who denigrate the Virgin Mary, and by the way, this doesn't go for all Protestants, because the classical reformers, even Martin Luther himself and John Calvin, they had a very high regard for the Virgin Mary. Now, they too wouldn't go so far as to, as we would say, pray to her, by which we mean ask her to pray for us. And by the grace of God, of course, the saints in heaven, including of course the Virgin Mary, have tremendous power, can be, by the permission of God, even appear on earth and overturn whole cities. See, the Virgin Mary has the power to overturn entire cities if she wants to. Now, of course, she doesn't do that because for reasons that we are not aware of. It's just like God. Every Protestant would believe that Christ can anytime appear on earth and decimate everybody, right? Nobody would deny that, but yet he doesn't do that. Obviously, there's a plan, but I'm talking about by the power that they have been, that has been bestowed on them, right? The saints in heaven have a tremendous amount of power. And throughout church history, the saints in heaven, various saints in heaven, have actually appeared on earth to them and helped them. So they not only do they pray for us, and their prayer is much more effective than any other believer's prayer on earth, but they also from time to time intervene and show their tremendous power by, for example, manipulating the normal laws of nature, i.e. miraculous events. And they of course continue to go on in the church to this very day. Right? That may be for another video, for another discussion. But hopefully now you Protestants who denigrate the Virgin Mary, even more so than Luther, who already didn't believe that much about the Virgin Mary, would not ask for her intercession as far as I can tell. But at least he would say that she is the Mother of God. He would give her due honor. That at least you modernist Protestants, including Baptists, free evangelical churches, etc., you would repent of that. The Virgin Mary is the woman clothed with the sun. She is more glorious. In fact, in one of our hymns, she is even higher than the seraphim and more glorious than the cherubim. You see? So even the cherubim and the seraphim are not as high as her, because she's the highest of all creatures. And that's why this chapter is written in her honor. God showed the Apostle John this mother whom Christ had told him before, behold your mother. So Christ says to John, behold your mother. And here, yes, behold your mother, O John. See this great wonder in heaven. This is your mother. This is the woman clothed with the sun. Should be obvious. And this is everybody's mother, of course, who is part of the church. The highest spiritual mother of all time, of all creatures.